Well, good morning, everybody. Our praise band is going to get us into worship this morning. So would you please quiet your hearts as we enter into a time of sacred worship? Be with you. Lift up your hearts. Well, good morning and welcome to Oxford United Methodist Church. My name is Pastor Caleb, and we do welcome you back here to Oxford United Methodist Church. And as we get into our worship service this morning, we do have a few announcements for you, and I trust you'll take some time during this service to fill out the yellow card that is in your bulletins this morning. First of all, remember that beginning on August 27th, we will go back to our regular worship schedule. That's 8:30 and 10:30. We'll have the 8:30 service down in the fellowship hall and the 10:30 up here as usual. So just remember that Sunday, August 27th, is when we go back to our regular worship. And the reason why we're waiting till August 27th to go back to that is that we have our Super Summer Sale coming up on August 19th down in the Fellowship Hall. I trust that you'll take some time this morning to look through that information. This is a part of the United Methodist Women / United Women in Faith. The proceeds from that sale go to benefit women, children, and youth. And so if you are wondering how you can help with that, you can contact us here at the church, or if you have items to donate, you can do that as well. This is done in conjunction with the community yard sale. Then, as many of you know, you've seen the news and all of the devastation that has occurred because of the wildfires down in Maui. Now, down in Maui is the Lahaina United Methodist Church, and it too was affected by the wildfires. And so This obviously hurts us because these are our brothers and sisters in the United Methodist Church who have lost their building of worship. And I want you to know that UMCOR is a wonderful organization that anytime there is a natural disaster or anything like this, they are the feet on the ground and they offer financial support and supplies. And so we just always want to bring before you UMCOR and the wonderful things that they do to help people in times like this. So I do ask that you would have in your hearts and minds this week in prayer to pray for Maui and for Lahaina United Methodist Church. And as we get into our worship service this morning, would you join with me in a moment of prayer? Grant to us, Lord, we pray, the Spirit to think and do always those things that are right, that we, who cannot exist without you, may by you be enabled to live according to your will. And Lord, we pray this as your church, sanctified by your Holy Spirit, that you would move in and through us for the sake of the good news of Jesus Christ. And so we pray through Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. At this time, would you please rise in body or in spirit as Nancy comes forward to lead us in our call to worship.
Praise the Lord. I will give thanks to the Lord with all my heart, in the company of the upright, in the congregation. Full of honor and majesty is the Lord's work, whose righteousness endures forever. God has gained renown by his wonderful deeds. The Lord is gracious and merciful. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All those who practice it have a good understanding.
And as you remain standing, we will be singing Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee, hymn number 89, all four verses.
Fill us with
You may be seated. And this morning, I'm going to ask that all our children and youth, you come up here. Some of you brought your backpacks. It's okay if you didn't bring your backpacks. I hope they'll make it with you to school when you go there. But come forward, because today we are doing a blessing of the backpacks. All right. And some of you can sit here in the second row. There we go. All right, guys. Well, up here we have some backpacks up here. We also have some school kits that our missions team has put together. And by the way, they made a request that I would let you know that they still need pencils, erasers, and $2 shipping. So if you are wanting to bless the school kits that we send around the world to bless children that need those items, please contact our missions or contact our office, and we would love to collect those items from you. But today we are doing a backpack blessing because you all get to go back to school this week, right? The happiest people in this room right now are your parents, because they know you're going back to school, and they're ready for you to go back. And we also want to bless our teachers and our administrators, and obviously we've got a lot of Miami University people here as well who are getting ready for all those college students to come back here in a couple weeks. And so we want to pray over all of your various new beginnings of this school year. Today we have before us backpacks to be carried to and from school by the children and youth gathered here. These backpacks will contain work to be done, work that's been returned, books to be studied, tools to complete homework, notebooks, pencils, pens, protractors, compasses, crayons, rulers, scissors, glue sticks, and other items used for schoolwork will find their way in and out of these backpacks. Some days, so much stuff will fill these backpacks that the student may find it difficult to walk. Other days, they will be light and nearly empty. But on each and every day, these backpacks represent work required of the students gathered here. And as in every aspect of our lives, we bring these before God for blessing at this time. So friends, if you would just extend, I know this is going to be a long blessing, so if you need to like prop your arm up on the pew in front of you, we like to extend our arms and pray over our students and teachers this morning. So would you extend your arms as we pray? Lord God, with you, every transition and new start is a reminder of your goodness, for you are always creating fresh, amazing things in us and through us. Though we are sad about the summer ending, we are grateful for this school year. We appreciate the opportunity to learn and grow, knowing it is one of the biggest privileges we have. With thanks and love, we now offer everything we are to you, asking for your blessing. We pray as and for students of all ages, abilities, and backgrounds. We pray for our hearts and all they hold, excitement and nervousness, disappointment and hope. We give you all of our loves and fears. We pray for steady self-esteem and deepening resilience.
We pray for our minds that they will expand in wonder and celebration, learning not just from the books studied, but the people beside us. Open our minds with a willingness to be changed in unexpected ways and settle our thought loops in peaceful places. We pray for our hands that they will reach out to help, welcome, and care. Bless our hands with patience and dedication as they grip pencils and type on keyboards, swish paintbrushes and clap in song, grip monkey bars and lunchbox handles, spin wheelchair tires and basketballs.
We pray for our mouths, that they will speak words bringing life and connection. Help us use our mouths to honor the dignity and belovedness of all. Remind us to open our mouths for deep belly breaths when we are feeling anxious or afraid. We pray for our feet, that they will move forward those different from us. Oh, they will move toward those different from us and help others in safe ways. Plant our feet next to those who feel alone and bless our steps down hallways and sidewalks. We know you are with us wherever our feet go or stay.
We pray for our eyes that they might see ourselves and others with compassion. Point our eyes toward those who are forgotten or struggling. Grow us in flexibility to see from all kinds of angles. Bless what and how we see, whether we're looking at a screen, a whiteboard, or the beauty of another person's face. Help us see with the most important eyes, the eyes of the Spirit within us. We pray for our ears that they will genuinely listen to all voices, especially those that haven't been listened to much. When things get noisy, help us listen extra carefully for your voice. Help us hear with the most important ears, the ears of the Spirit within us.
We say a special prayer for parents, as the start of a new school year is always another leap of faith. Wrap them with your reassuring love as they entrust their children and trust in you. When questions remain unanswered and the realm of control is finite, bless them with peace and the promise you are right there with their child, whether heading to preschool or driving to college. We also pray now for teachers, staff, and administrators. Bless these faithful servants with courage and confidence, knowing you are in their classroom with a steady hand on their shoulder. Give them peace, patience, and balance in the pressures they face, and bravery to build structures and systems which justly serve all your children. Give them delight in the young ones before them and recognition of the sweet ways children are also teachers.
We pray for health and wholeness, fun and growth, surprise and amazement. For this school year ahead, knowing you will hold us all the way through. We thank you, God, and love you. In your name, amen.
Amen. All right, students, before you go off to Children's Church, I want to make a special announcement and introduction this morning. So I'm going to invite Reverend Katie Steele to come forward, since we're talking about students going back to school and all of that important stuff. I wanted to introduce Katie Steele to all of you. If you read the Friday update this week, you know that Katie Steele has been appointed to serve here at Oxford United Methodist Church in partnership with the Wesley Foundation at the University of Cincinnati. Now, we won't hold the UC thing against her or the Wesley Foundation, but we are grateful for this opportunity, which allows us to provide a new Wesley campus ministry to our students in and through this church. Many of you know years ago the Wesley Foundation that was here at Miami University, and that has been gone for quite some time. And so Katie is going to be building upon the legacy of the Wesley Foundation there and all the other college ministries that we've had in the time between. And we are just grateful that she is here with us and is going to be on campus with our students to bless them. And you probably know this from the Friday update that we began the ordination process roughly at the same time. We were in the Crucible group together, so I got to know Katie very well during that time. And I don't know, Katie, do you have anything you want to say this morning? You're ordained like me. We always have something to talk about. So,
Speaking of meeting folks on campus, not just students, all of you, my seminary advisor was very adamant that the third Methodist sacrament is actually coffee. So if you'd like to meet up for a cup of coffee or anything like that, please be in touch, and I'd love to build some connections with everyone.
Yes. And before you sit down, and actually, Katie, we're introducing her this morning, but she is at, what is it, a out retreat?
Reunion.
So she's going to be flying out of here, but she's going to have office hours, and you'll have time to connect with her. It's been a very busy summer for all. Yes, she's got to go clean the lodge today. And so before she goes and before our children go, let us say a prayer of blessing over Katie and the new Wesley Campus Ministry. Lord God, we give you thanks for the gift of your grace, which is always present to us. And Lord, we are thankful for the ways in which your grace grows within us and leads us in mission together. And we are thankful today that Katie has come to us to help our church, our community, our university connect with your life-giving love for all people. We're thankful for the gifts that she brings and the passion that she brings with her to serve our students, to connect them with you, and to connect them with each other and provide a safe and inclusive space for all people to discern your love for them and your call upon their lives. So, Lord, we bless you for Katie and ask your special blessing upon this new ministry opportunity for us and for our university. We pray this in your holy name. Amen. Well, would you welcome Katie this morning? And now, young friends, you may go to Children's Church. You can keep them in here. You can take it if you want to.
As we begin our time of prayer, I encourage you to talk with God about your individual concerns, and don't forget to ask blessings for yourself. If you desire, please come forward and light a candle to add honor and emphasis to a particular concern. Following that, we'll have the congregational prayer. Lord God, you know us. You know our every thought, every deed, every desire, and every need. And yet you still welcome us, forgive us, and love us. We desire to follow you, but you know, we're busy. We're distracted, we're tempted. Tempted to do things that we shouldn't do, tempted to leave undone things that we should do. So once again, we're gathering here as your children to support each other in our efforts and our lives, to honor you, to worship you, to ask your forgiveness, and to ask for your continued blessings. As we look back over the summer, we're grateful. Grateful for the many, many blessings that we have enjoyed. The time together, the trips we took, the people we saw, the festivities we participated in, games we played, food we ate, love we received, and the many opportunities that we had to share our blessings and to bless others. We are also grateful that we may not have done everything that we had wanted or planned, because that gives us hopes, joys, and plans to look forward to in future summers. A new school year is upon us, and we greet it with a variety of thoughts and feelings. Excitement, anxiety, joy, anticipation, or for some it may be dread, a sense of urgency, or sadness that we'll no longer be enjoying those long days, quiet streets, and the more relaxed schedules that summer brings to some. Help us to embrace this coming school year. And please be with all the students, teachers, staff, parents, and everyone who has a role in making this year a success. Bless us all, and also help us to bless others, to remember that we are all your children, and that it is important that each and every student be successful, not only with academics, but in their development, in their feelings, feeling loved and important, confident, and building strong characters with good morals. Help us to speak out and take action when we see the need and have the ability to grease the skids and smooth the paths and lift the spirits of those around us. Father, our world is full of needs that only you can fill, and we ask for your help and blessings on each person in need. Heavy on our hearts and minds right now are those in Hawaii, those who have lost lives, friends, families, as well as those that have lost all their possessions, their jobs, their treasures, their lifestyles, and almost everything that they know from those devastating wildfires. Please, Lord, be there with them in each and every hour, providing not only the food, water, and shelter, but also the comfort, hope, strength, and wisdom that is needed. As we see the images and note the resemblances to war zones, let us not forget that there are many people still living in war zones, and many soldiers fighting in wars that they may or may not even understand. Please step in and protect the innocent. Guide the hearts and minds of the leaders and help them to find a peaceful resolution. Closer to home, the news each day is filled with stories of violence, shootings, and death, often caused by people who feel that they are desperate at the ends of their ropes, people who may not know you or know that they have other options. We ask you to use us, to intervene and to help, to protect those in the area, to guide not only our leaders and those enforcing our laws, but all of us. Guide those who've turned to violence and comfort those who are suffering the senseless losses. Within our congregation and our families, our circles of friends, we have many needs as well. Whether we put those needs in words or not, you know what they are. Please provide the strength, the healing, the comfort, and the health that we so strongly desire. Help us each to know what our role is in each of these situations, how we can help, and then help us to act. Throughout each day, in everything we do, help us to be grateful and to praise you always. Hear us as now as we pray the prayer taught to us so long ago. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins. We forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
As you remain seated, our next hymn today is Open My Eyes That I May See, hymn number 454. You may remain seated as we sing this song and prepare our hearts for the scripture to be read this morning.
Today's scripture comes from 2 Corinthians 12, verses 1 through 10, Paul's vision and his thorn. I must go on boasting. Although there is nothing to be gained, I will go on to visions and revelations from the Lord. I know a man in Christ who 14 years ago was caught up to the third heaven. Whether it was in the body or out of the body, I do not know, but God knows. And I know that this man, whether in the body or apart from the body, I do not know, but God knows, was caught up to paradise and heard inexpressible things, things that no one is permitted to tell. I will boast about a man like that, but I will not boast about myself, except about my weaknesses. Even if I should choose to boast, I would not be a fool, because I would be speaking the truth. But I refrain, so no one will think more of me than is warranted by what I do or say. Or because of these surpassing great revelations. Therefore, in order to keep me from becoming conceited, I was given a thorn in my flesh, a messenger of Satan, to torment me. Three times I pleaded with the Lord to take it away from me. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you. For my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me. That is why, for Christ's sake, I delight in weaknesses, in insults, in hardships, in persecutions, in difficulties. For when I am weak, then I am strong. The word of God for the people of God.
Anytime the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, shows up, disruption occurs. This is what we heard last week from Peter himself. He gives this report before a council of members who have heard rumors of him, including Gentiles in the movement, and eating with them at the same table. And he reports this great movement of the Holy Spirit to disrupt their worldview, to disrupt their very lives, and bring these people in. We see in the book of Acts that the Holy Spirit is the primary agent, a disruptive power in the church. And as we learned last week, the church is founded upon the disruption of the Holy Spirit throughout time. And we learned that just like the Holy Spirit, grace is also disruptive. In fact, grace that is not disruptive is not grace. As George Hunsinger said, the grace of God really comes to lost sinners, but in coming, it disrupts them to the core. It slays to make alive and sets the captive free. Grace may, of course, work silently and secretly like a germinating seed as well as a bolt from the blue. It is always holy, as incalculable as it is reliable, unmerited, and full of blessing. Yet, it is necessarily as unsettling as it is comforting. It does not finally teach of its own sufficiency without appointing a thorn in the flesh. Grace is disruptive because God does not compromise with sin, nor ignore it, nor call it good. On the contrary, God removes it by submitting it to the cross to show that love is stronger than death. And this week we will learn another aspect of grace. Yes, grace is also disruptive, but it is also sufficient for all things. And George Hunsinger mentions it right there in the middle. He says it does not finally teach of its own sufficiency without appointing a thorn in the flesh. And so today that brings us to the Apostle Paul. That brings us yet again to another vision that occurs. Just like Peter, Paul has had a vision, and this vision was from a long time ago. He relates it in the third person. He says, I know a man who was caught up into the third heaven, whether in body or however, he does not know, only God knows. And he heard things that are not to be told on earth. No mortal is permitted to speak these things. And this vision that he is relating to the Corinthians, he brings it up almost as if to discard it from the very instance he mentions it. He doesn't want to focus too much on it, but he still feels like, I need to tell you about this vision that I had the other day where God caught me up to heaven. He almost wants to say he has this extraordinary experience about getting caught up in heaven, but he doesn't want the people to get too caught up in that fact. It's kind of weird. It's like he's saying, like, I know this really famous person. Like, I don't want to mention them, but I just want you to know I know this really famous person, and I'm really cool for knowing this person. Like, why would you mention that and not tell us? Like, why is it so important? And he goes on, I don't want you to get caught up in this vision either, because Paul doesn't want to boast in this great thing that's happened. Usually people relate visions from God in order to bolster their credentials amongst a community of people. Hey, the other night, God visited me and God told me what we need to do. That's a way of asserting your authority in a community and showing that, hey, God has done something powerful in my life. But Paul is like, I'm mentioning it, but I don't want you to focus too much on that. Because what I really want to focus on is my weaknesses. And the fact that I'm not all that. Paul is threading together an argument of great importance because he believes in the power of God manifest in Jesus Christ, and he wants his weakness to be the focus so that we can see this power at work in him. Instead of boasting in his strength, he boasts in his weakness. He could have boasted in this vision that he is given, but he wants to distance himself from that so much that he uses the third person for himself. Are you one of those people that uses the third person for yourself? Like, you always sound arrogant when you use the third person about yourself. So it's like, what's Paul doing here? He's not boasting in it. He just wants to say, look, I'm weak. I don't have everything. But I'll tell you who does and what I've experienced through God's grace. I mean, I can tell you this morning, boasting in your weaknesses is certainly something that they don't train you to do when you're going to an interview for a job, right? Like, I don't want to tell you about my strengths. I want to tell you about my weaknesses. And because of my weaknesses, you're going to hire me, right? Like, we don't do that. We're like, downplay your imperfections or all your weaknesses. You know, mention them, but don't highlight them to the point that they take the focus off your strengths. And Paul's like, no, that's not how my resume is going to work. My resume is one in which my weaknesses are the highlight because it's God's grace that I want to focus on. And so to keep Paul from boasting, and he knows, he admits, like, we can know this about Paul. Like, he mentions the vision. We know he just wants to boast in that. But to keep him from boasting in that and getting too joyful or too elated about it, he says in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 7, therefore, to keep me from being too elated, a thorn was given me in the flesh, a messenger of Satan to torment me, to keep me from being too elated. Paul is acknowledging that it's impossible for him on his own to keep from boasting in his strengths and this vision that he's had, and that is why God appoints this thorn in the flesh. But what is this thorn? This is the thing that people have been debating for a long time. For decades, people have tried to figure this out. What is it exactly that Paul was experiencing? And it's not until recently that I think someone has actually discovered the true answer. And it comes to us through a comic. It's SpongeBob SquarePants. That is the thorn in his flesh sent to annoy him. Some of you are getting the theme song for SpongeBob in your head this morning. I'm so sorry for that. I'm kidding here, but maybe it's not that far off. But truth is, no one really knows what the thorn in Paul's flesh really was. Some have postulated that it's migraines. Some of you that have experienced migraines know that, hey, that's a lot to deal with. You know, migraines are crippling. Some have said that he experienced a vision impairment of some sort. Some have mentioned it was the other apostles. We just know from Paul's prickly character that he didn't get along with a lot of people. And so maybe it was just other apostles around him. He's always getting on their case for the things that they're doing. I mean, Paul had a thorn in the flesh, but also a thorny disposition. So maybe it was other apostles. We don't know for sure, but just like the vision, the thorn isn't the point here. It is the purpose of the thorn. The thorn is there to keep him from getting too elated. And now, we know that the thorn can't be something that's not that serious. We know he asks for it to be removed 3 times, right? Like, this isn't just a minor toothache or some indigestion or anything. This is a serious thing. Otherwise, Paul would not have asked for it to be removed 3 times. But the purpose of this thorn is to remind him of something important, that God's grace is important, that God's grace is sufficient. Now, to think this morning of what our weaknesses are, because Paul says it's in my weakness that I learn this important lesson about God's grace, Paul doesn't mention imperfections, but I think they're instructive here because Paul knows that God's power is made perfect in weakness. And in the same way, I think God's power is made perfect, yes, even in our imperfections. I mean, how's that even possible? I mean, it sounds ridiculous that our weaknesses actually would be our strength. If you've watched one of the most recent Jumanji movies, the first reboot, the Jumanji Welcome to the Jungle, there's four teenage characters in that movie, and they get thrown into a video game, and they're different characters. They're the characters of the video games. They're still human. They're not like a video game that you would normally think, but they're in this game, and one of the characters, who was the football player, he becomes a character who's played by Kevin Hart, who's very short and all that. And there's a scene where each of the characters gets to, like, they tap their chest and it shows up above them, kind of like in a video game, a screen that shows their strengths and their weaknesses. And so Kevin Hart's character does that, and everybody else, like, they have really cool strengths and a few interesting weaknesses. But his comes up and there's no strengths listed at all. But there's three weaknesses. The first one, cake. Yeah, right? Like, that's an obvious weakness for everybody, right? The second one is strength, and the third one is speed. And he's, like, making this comical yet philosophical point. Like, how can your strength be your weakness? Like, I don't understand. Like, how is that even possible? How can strength be a weakness? And in the same way, this morning, we might be saying, how are our weaknesses actually our strength? And it's not because of anything within us. It's because of what God's grace does through us. And I want to focus on our imperfections this morning because, believe me, we all have them. All of us. There's a lot of different weaknesses we could focus on this morning. But this morning, I want to focus on our imperfections. Because when I think about our society doesn't really like our imperfections that much, or doesn't want to deal with our imperfections. They either want us to ignore our imperfections or work on improving them as much as possible, do anything other than boast in them, right? Like, I don't want you to leave here today just like being a boastful person, but I want you to see this morning that your imperfections do not hold you back. They're there in some way as a gift to help you receive God's grace and understand that God's grace is enough. But I want to ask you this morning, what do you think of your imperfections? If you could tap your chest, and like in Jumanji, like a screen comes up and it shows all of your imperfections on the screen for you to see and everybody else to see, how comfortable are you with that? We're not too good with that. You'd be like, no. And some of us think of our imperfections as like annoying companions. They go with us everywhere. And they're sources of great embarrassment to us. And that's why maybe some people deny that they have imperfections to begin with. And I also think it's important to note for us this morning that imperfections come in all types and all kinds of varieties. Some are just simply the result of being a human, and some are the result of our unique personalities. Some can be improved upon, and some others, no matter how hard you try, you can never improve upon them. Some of them lead us to trust and to depend upon others, and some of our imperfections lead us away from community altogether, making us think that we are better on our own. Some imperfections are shared across the whole community, and then some imperfections belong only to us as individuals, and we feel alone that we're the only one with our particular imperfections. But regardless of the type or variety, imperfections are really not received well in today's society, and this is why I think Paul's teaching to us is so instructive. Paul wants us to rely upon God's grace despite our imperfections. And we live in a world, friends, that values many things, but two things in particular I want to focus on today in context with our imperfections. Our world values efficiency and productivity. And your imperfections don't really play into those things. Your whole goal at your jobs or in life in general is to become more efficient and more productive. Such a world wants us to limit the number of imperfections in us as much as possible. And we have whole industries that have popped up to help us overcome our imperfections in order to become more efficient people, in order to become producers. Like, your whole role in life is to be a consumer and a producer. And we only value you according to those things, society says. And if you were known and valued by what you produce, then you will carry this burden of perfectionism all the time. Because you believe that the more you do, the more efficient you become, the more value you bring, not just to your company or to your university or to even your family or your church. We think we have to overcome our imperfections in order to increase our value. And Kelly Capick explains just how destructive this view of life really is in his book, You're Only Human. He says, it is not difficult to see how easily we have imposed a scale of being efficient onto our perception of being human. Consequently, valuing people in terms of productivity and speed, good and bad are ideas we often unconsciously link with models of industry, sometimes causing us to apply mechanistic notions to people without ever realizing that this causes us to treat people as if they were machines. We try to be human doings instead of human beings. The dehumanizing effects of this become quickly apparent. See, the point here is that when we try to fit ourselves and others into these models of production and efficiency, we engage in a process of dehumanization for ourselves and others, especially when we expect them to work on their imperfections so much so that they become more valuable assets to our company and more efficient. But friends, there is a lie here. And the lie of efficiency is that your imperfections need to be overcome in order to increase your value. But the truth of the gospel is that your value is already secured by the love of God in Christ Jesus. Now, friends, it's easy to think of God's grace making us more efficient and proficient in the things we do. And yes, grace does that for us. But the point here is not that grace makes us a better producer. Grace is meant to actually help us become better lovers of other people and all of creation. When you live from this standpoint of grace, you learn to trust that God will use you despite your imperfections, but God will also use you through your imperfections. God says to us, just as God said to the Apostle Paul, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. In a society of productivity and efficiency, we value things like speed and ability. That's what a society of productivity ultimately is about. Can you get it done? And how fast can you get it done? And so today, I think we need to get comfortable with a word called process. That we're all works in process. Our whole lives is a work in process. Our faith is a work in process. It's easy for us often to think like, God, just do it right now. I'm impatient. Just make me better person. Make me more proficient. Make me more efficient. And God gives us grace that is sufficient in order to tell us it's okay to take your time. And you need to take time with yourself. Because friends, we are not cogs in a machine. We are children of God. We are not meant to just keep the wheels spinning. We are meant to enjoy community and the gift of life together. And that is why this morning we need a holy reckoning. That process and our imperfections, those things are a gift to us. We want to hurry things, be more efficient. But the beauty of God's grace is that it is sufficient. It doesn't matter how proficient you are in your faith or in life. God's grace will always and only be the only thing that is sufficient for you. So we need to change our perspective on our imperfections. We need to change our perspective on process. We want God to hurry up, just make us better and more perfect now. But God's grace and process are not opposed to one another. Part of living into the power of God's grace is understanding its greatest power comes to us as we engage in a life of process, that we're growing. We don't have to be these perfect people who've got it all there, because our value doesn't depend upon what we can do. Our value is already secured by the love of God in Christ Jesus. And that's what discipleship's about. Like, we wouldn't even have a word called discipleship if you were not meant to take a lifetime of process and growing. But even through that and the struggle with your imperfections, God's grace is still going to come to you all the same. So our world thinks that if you don't get better at those imperfections, that your value to society decreases. But we have to live with the confidence that's the exact opposite of that, that our value is already there. Capek reminds us, and I'll end us with this. Christianity's goal has never been mere inner peace, nor endless programs of self-improvement, strength training, or better education. All those things are good. But he's saying this has not been the goal of Christianity, of our faith in Jesus Christ. He says Christianity's goal, or telos, it's a Greek word for goal, has always been to grow in love and communion with God, our neighbors, and the rest of his creation. Friends, may we find it in ourselves to live out of this holy reckoning regarding ourselves and our imperfections, that the power of God's grace would truly be sufficient for us. And no matter whether we leave here today with a thorn in our flesh that will or will not be removed, but we will always live with this understanding that God and his grace is not only available to us, but it is sufficient for all things. So friends, let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks for your grace, which is greater than anything in our lives, including our sin. And Lord, we know that this sufficient grace is also disruptive, that it takes all the things within us that we think are terrible, and it renders miracles from those things, that we might experience your love and your grace immeasurably. And so, Lord, this morning, we pray that we would receive your word, that your power is made perfect in our weaknesses, including our imperfections. And may your grace always be enough, that we never lose sight of nor confidence in your love for us. Lord, we pray this in your Son's holy name. Amen. And now would you please rise in body or in spirit as we sing our final hymn, hymn number 365, Grace Greater Than Our Sin. We will sing the first and fourth verse.
Thank you.
I do want to remind our families this morning that our children's director, Taylor, wants to hear your questions about the children's ministry program after worship today. So you are invited to go to the Christian education wing up in one of the classrooms there, and she'd be glad to meet with you. I believe she has some like contact information forms, allergy forms, all that kind of stuff that we need filled out if you would take some time after service. And also for the rest of you, you are invited to a time of fellowship in the Memorial Lounge, which is in the same direction. You just keep going straight until you end up in the lounge through these doors as you depart today. Well, friends, grace upon grace is what God has given us in Jesus Christ. And that grace is sufficient for even you. For God's power is made perfect even in your imperfections. Go in his grace this day in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Let us sing together.